little bit about myself. For the last 3 years, I've been working at the Boys and Girls Clubs of Boston. I work in Dorchester, the Blue Hill Boys and Girls Club. And I also work for another organization called the Clubhouse Network. It was formerly called the Intel Computer Clubhouse. There are 100 different Intel Computer Clubhouses, or the Clubhouse, whatever it's called now, around the world. So I have coworkers in India, South America, Australia, New Zealand, other parts of the US. We all meet up once a year to talk about different cool things that we're doing. So I started this workshop to teach them how to use this so that they can teach their kids around the world how to use it. Before that, I was a DJ, and I used open source software to do my DJ sets. And then I had a Raspberry Pi running connected to a TV or a projector or a big screen TV, and it was doing ASCII art video, which is what I have pulled up here. The reason I like awesome is because I can make it fully full screen without the program having that functionality.
Yeah, we're still on the question answer period. Since people want to ask you questions.
If anybody has any questions about that, my background, I'll be moving to a different position in a mobile tech lab where I'm going around to different schools, libraries, after-school centers, and I'll be teaching programming and maker DIY type activities to kids.
What was the software you used for DJing?
Mix is what I mostly use. I use a MIDI keyboard, not a MIDI scratch deck, but like a 25 key piano. Mm-hmm. And it all wired to different things. Enough knobs to tweak the sound. I've done a couple non-profit events, weddings, stuff like that.
And this Intel Club, what is it? I guess the goal is just to educate people, or is there?
Well, technology education in schools is very limited. From what I've seen, it's typing, Microsoft Office, and that's about it.
Wow.
So what we do is 3D modeling, 3D printing, programming, graphic design, web design, program, game design, whatever the kids are interested in. We'll try to help them work through that. If any of you are looking for work, I will pitch that you should check out the Boys and Girls Club if you want to give back something to kids. Any other questions? It could be about single board computers.
What version of the Raspberry Pi do you recommend our older ones find to use for the things you're kind of doing today? Or is the absolute newest the one to use?
It all depends what you want to do. At work, I have a lot of B pluses.
Okay.
And they do most of the things I put it through. If you want to do like photo editing, get BLU.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to run a little web server or something, depending on the use case, the original could work.
What was the one that was popular about a year ago? I bought one, I haven't touched it, and I have no idea what it is, and I'm wondering if it's too old to use or not.
None of them are too old to use.
Okay.
I was VJing off of the original 1B. Goes a little slower, renders video.
Yeah.
Slower, more choppy, but it works.
The 3 is cheaper though, isn't it?
They're all under $40.
Yeah, no, I mean, you can buy it for $30 at Micro Center.
Right.
And the 3 includes a Wi-Fi chip and more memory and a faster processor.
So I'll be doing this talk on the 3B. I've used the zeros plenty. I've used the 2B. The original B, the B plus, the A, plus. I've used some of the other Singapore computers as well, the Banana Pi.
BeagleBoard?
I haven't used the BeagleBoard. What's the other one I've used?
Have you done a lot with Arduino?
A bit. You can do a lot of the same stuff with the Raspberry Pi as well.
Well, here's, if you've used Raspberry Pi a lot, you do a lot with analog and digital inputs. The reason I went with an Arduino instead of a Raspberry Pi was I needed like 20 or 30 digital inputs and like 10 analog inputs. So I didn't find any solution that was really easy to use with a Raspberry Pi for that, compared to the boards on the Arduino that have the Mega, at least has that stuff built in.
Right. If you need a full computer to run a lot of inputs and outputs, analog and digital, there is a really weird one that I haven't got my hands on called the compute module. It's in the form factor of a memory stick, but it's a computer. So it uses all the 200 pins as input outputs. If you're really into hardware, it's harder to get your hands on that. You can't get it at Micro Center, but.
Raspberry Pi compute module. That's,
yeah.
Okay, interesting. Okay.
It's a weird one. I don't think it ever got really popular because people were sticking them in RAM or didn't know the difference. Because it looks like a RAM stick.
Wow.
I don't know. I haven't seen anyone or heard of anyone with it, so it exists, theoretically.
How would you even get things, like how would you separate out the ports from there? Even you would need some kind of adapter to do that.
I don't know much about the compute module.
Yeah.
I don't know how you get a video display to it, maybe SSH into it, I don't know.
It's got, you can't see this, but it's got an I.O. board that it plugs into, so it's sort of like, why bother to buy it? It's for people that are designing PCBs, and they can take that and pin out there, but it's got an I.O. board that you can buy for it.
I see it.
You plug that in, and then it'll, you know, separate all of those out. It's pretty cool, though.
So if you're really into development, you go that route. Not very many people go that route. Has anybody used the Raspberry Pi or any of the other boards? What are some of the projects you're doing with them? Now I'm asking the question.
I use that. I use mine as a video player.
Okay. Cody or are you running XBMC Cody or just OMX player and player?
Just, it's called OMX player.
Yeah.
Little XINID, the basic accept requests for NFS paths to videos on my NASA, and then just place them.
I have the 2B running connected to my TV, to Kodi, so I could do the same thing. It's got more of a big format, so I can connect to it with my phone.
Surprised how well it works.
Works great.
And a lot of 1080p videos that were always like stalling during playback on my desktop.
Right, this laptop can't run HD video, but it's $30.
I'm sure it was network bandwidth or just a bit of it. As soon as they threw it on the Raspberry Pi, I played lots of it.
I want to do some Python code with reading some pretty standard serial in and out, but I haven't got around to doing it. Just started working on it, but have had problems with Python 2, Python 3. Things don't quite work, it gets messy, so I'm in that mess right now.
It's kind of confusing going into it. I'll touch on that a little bit. I have an LED light connected to this. I'll turn it on and off with Python.
Have you played with the Intel Einstein or the Galileo?
I have not. And the reason for that is the higher cost.
Yeah.
With the lower cost boards, you don't tend to worry about the risk involved.
Of just picking one up and
right.
I have no use for this, putting it on the shelf.
If I really push the Intel Galileo or whatever the new ones are called to the max, I fry it, that'll probably be the end of my Galileo experience. I work with kids a lot, so.
They break stuff.
Yeah.
And the only reason I asked is because I had a Python project that I was using that for, and it was actually really, really fast. But again, you're looking at 90-something dollars compared to 30-something dollars, and that makes sense for kids and for projects like this.
Right. It all depends on the scale of your project. If you have a heavier project, maybe a full computer is better for it. Most of the time, with the projects I put together, I have three running at work. I don't need full computers running at 120 volts all the time.
I just wanted to try one of those IoT things, just make it read temperature, send it somewhere else. I'm just playing with that, but even that was not trivial.
Right. I have a box up here as an example. I haven't done it myself, but you know, you could get a weatherproof box, stick a sensor out the bottom, or set it up to email you or text you when things are going on. I got this box for $4. It's a thrift store find of for lawn and garden automation, but you could repurpose it to do whatever you want. I'm not really into the hardware aspect of it, so like I have two motors, you could connect a board to it and power the motors, but I don't know enough about hardware to take the time to make it work. If you're really into hardware and you want to try it out, set some time aside and play around with this stuff. Any other projects anyone's thinking about? Something you saw?
Running one right now, but this is not Raspberry Pi, it is Arduino.
Okay.
But it takes a bunch of voltage measurements in, goes into the analog inputs, the digital outputs control the thing that is doing the voltage measurements to allow it just to do different things. That goes from the Arduino and does a bunch of math on it. Pulls it through, puts it through a Bluetooth board, which is directly above it. The Bluetooth board transmits to an iPhone app. The iPhone app grabs that data, displays a graph of the data, and then it FTPs it up to a server connected over AWS. And the whole board is topped with a battery charger with a little battery down there. So the whole thing, we have a 3D printed box. The whole thing, and an LCD up top to show everything. The whole thing is just like yay big, and it could be a lot smaller. And it does everything we need, but that's with add-on boards. It's not a full computer. It's, adding functionality on, but it takes very little power and does very little, computation.
Okay. Generally, use the tool that works. If you have it working on the Arduino.
We tried it with the Galileo, but.
No sense in changing if it works.
Yeah, I mean, the Galileo was too, it was overkill.
Right.
For that kind of project, that's what it ended up being, because we're making 25 of these to start out with, so the cost adds up.
unfortunately looked much better on that long server than on the projector.
Well, it is ASCII art, so further away, the more you squint, better it looks.
Yeah, I'll adjust the lights a little bit later before. I'll officially start Michael in about 10 minutes or 15 minutes, because we always have a few stragglers between 7 and 7:15. And also, let me just have a show of hands of those who might be going to the brewery. I'll ask a little bit later. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we get 6 tonight.
What brewery?
We usually go to the Cambridge Brewery after the meeting.
Okay.
It's in walking distance.
No, I know where it is.
Yep.
I've been there.
We've gone to a lot of other places, but the brewery has always accommodated us, in contrast to some of these other places where they like to close their kitchen, we get there too late, and, you know, we're the only people there. And
the Cambridge Brewery closes their kitchen if we get there too late anyway, it's just they close late enough. But
you know, they close it, you know, some places close their kitchen at 10, but you know, a lot of places don't like to start serving you after 9. You know, and but we've gone to a number of places that either the service was terrible, like the Sunset Grill or whatever the hell John Malloy's favorite place is, or we went to another place that couldn't accommodate us. You know, while we'd like something better than the brewery, it's the best place for us.
The new barbecue place opened right next door to it, though.
Yeah.
They're probably open late, but they're probably very expensive.
Yeah. The only one I'd probably want to go there after our meeting is probably Rocky. And when Rocky starts paying for the install fests, you know, well, of course, he won his court case, didn't he? Rocky was in the Globe, was in actually the Globe and the Herald. He had sued his ex, person that actually cheated him out of a house.
Oh, jeez.
Rocky is kind of a mathematician who used to work at MIT, or Draper Labs. Comes to some of our meetings, usually he's somewhat disruptive, and he comes to our install fests. I also have a shot of him where he took a lounge chair, got a lounge chair up on a Riverside train, or no, a Beacon Street train. Made it on the newspapers. So he's kind of famous.
So I got my Raspberry Pi here, but how do I get on to the local network here? I mean, I'm really running headless.
Do you have Wi-Fi?
Yeah, but it wouldn't just find something and try it. How would I even?
Your Headless ID, it's just MIT.
If you're running headless, you have to set it up prior.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ah. You can't just go to a new place and expect to find your way.
Right. But if you know what the Wi-Fi details are ahead of time, you could
MIT guess.
Program that ahead of time.
I think they would have a script that just stands for open networks and connects to the first one that gives you an internet.
It should be, right?
Yeah.
I don't think they would.
Because MIT's got a great bandwidth
in
their Wi-Fi here.
is the volume control of this? Is there a way to mute it?
Are you picking up the sound from this?
Oh, yeah, that's the Pi.
Okay, let me see.
I turned this all the way down. I didn't see anything.
Oh,
okay.
I did.
Cool.
Seeing another pair of eyes. Yeah. Well, work, I have a mallet on my desk that works too. Happened in my aisle. We had an intern sitting at the end of my aisle, and he supposedly finished off last Friday, and so a new guy in our group came in, has been sitting off in some other area, and facilities, you know, officially moved him to my aisle. And while the intern came back, apparently he was extended, but nobody knew about it. And there's also the guy that has the office across from that desk also had slated somebody else to sit in there. So we won because we went through facilities. The guy actually, Diogenes, who sat there, is going to be our January speaker. He was working on performance of file systems, and he was working in the Gloucester group. So,
XFS versus JFS versus.
He was working mostly distributed file system, Gloucester versus Ceph. Primarily, you know, when you're dealing with the cloud storage systems, you've got storage distributed all over the world. You know, you don't know where your file is. You've got extents of your file in a number of different places. We've already had a Ceph presentation, and we had a MooCFS presentation on that. But essentially, the new distributed file systems are somewhat crazy in the way they work. That made sense, but you know, whether your file, each extent of your file is, you know, every block of your file is somewhere else, and it's replicated two or three times or four times or whatever. So, and they're replicated by the block, not by the file. So, they have to keep track of all of this. It's crazy.
Defragmentation
is irrelevant. They keep track of that because let's say that.
Well, I'm just sort of pointing out that with such a file system, it would be an interesting.
Well, yeah, because you're talking about. You're talking about many, many disks in many, many different locations. So if you lose an entire data center, you're not going to lose your file. That's the whole thing. If you lose a disk, you know, they go in there, replace the disk, you know, everything does. We don't care what's on the disk. What they care about is the integrity of the files. So if a node goes out, a node goes out. You know, a file loses one of its replicas, those replicas will get re-replicated. So you've got replications of all of those. So it really doesn't matter. Of course, you know, you probably want to move data in onto some faster media, some data that's used more often. So you need algorithms like that. But, you know, the old fragmentation algorithms don't work at all because you don't care about fragmentation.
As a tree, you don't care about it, there's nothing you can do about it.
Well, you probably care about it.
But you can't do it.
You know, you're talking about files that live in many, many different places. You don't care about it on a per file basis. You know, you're more interested in caching and stuff like that.
Yeah, you would still like to get the best
situation.
Yeah.
Exactly. It's just
not practical to do anything.
It's just if your data is on the cloud somewhere and you're getting it over comm line, there's a lot of, you know, it's much different from getting it from a local disk. Because your disk speeds are fast. So it's a matter of that, and that's really what they have to deal with in clouds and stuff like that. Mike, we can start.
All right.
The last important straggler is here. And Bill. Okay, I'd just like to introduce Mike McMahon. Mike's going to talk about Raspberry Pi programming. He has Pi sitting right here.
Well, thank you, Jared. Thank you, Boston Linux and UNIX Users Group. Very excited to share this presentation with you. I'm most excited about it because I want your feedback. I want to make this better. I want to get as many people using the new Linux, whatever you want to call it. It's a great programming environment. And I think that the Raspberry Pi is a great way to introduce that. It's a big step to say, take your laptop that you depend on every day. And, you know, I know you have all your files on there, but dump it. And let's start fresh with this new thing. It'll take a long time to learn, but trust me, it's worth it after 5 years.
Sign me up.
I mean, that's what I did, but I'm sure many of you did it as well, but that's a lot to ask for somebody. It's a lot easier to say, you can go down the street to Micro Center, and for $60 you can get a computer that you can plug into things that you already have. For TV, it could be instead of an Xbox station, it could be a programming environment. That's powerful. I work with kids, I work with the Boys and Girls Club, and with the Clubhouse Network, I work with kids all over the world. And I work with poor kids. Every poor kid has an Xbox or a PlayStation 4, and they're buying these new games of Call of Duty, whatever, Grand Theft Auto. They have money to buy shoes, games, so forth. What if instead of buying a game that they'll play for 4 hours, what if they buy a computer that can turn into a lifelong career? So I've been giving away pies. I've been showing kids how to use them, giving them away, letting them take it home. It's cheap enough that they can make mistakes. Sometimes they break it. Sometimes they come back crying the next day. I know you're gonna be mad, but I broke this thing. You gave it to me, you entrusted it with me. Can you make it work again? I'm never mad. I'll try to troubleshoot it. If I can't do it, it's $30. I can get another one. So with that, there's low risk. And with low risk, you can take more risks. It's also a very low power system. I'll get you in a second. So for programming and web design, low power systems are great. I see a lot of web designers that use these shiny things with a piece of fruit on it, and they test all of their things on this shiny high-end thing. And then when people try to go to their web page on a phone or an older computer, it may not work. If you had designed it and tested it on a low-end 5-volt system, you might have found some things that would have prevented you from putting it out there to begin with. Just a thought. You can design on whatever you like. It's all preference, but that's the way I look at it. If you can make it efficient from the beginning, should be better in the long term, and it should work for everyone. So I'm going to show you my first project.
Let me turn down some of the lights.
Okay.
So people can see it better.
I have this running off my laptop. This will be the only thing, I'll show you some slides too, but this will be mostly the only thing that I'm running off this laptop. There's a conflict between some of the other software that I'll show you later and this piece of software. This is a modified mPlayer, and I used to DJ special events for nonprofits, weddings, house parties, so forth. And I used open source software for that. And to accompany that, I also VJ'd live. And I love ASCII art. So to be more thematic with the open source software, I use a Raspberry Pi, the original Model B, and I connected to whatever I had there, whether it's a TV or a projector. And I'll show you a little bit of this. I have this running in the awesome window manager with modified settings so that it's absolute full screen. So this is the same video that we were watching a moment ago, but it's entirely rendered in ASCII art live. And with that, I can modify it, I can invert the colors, and I can change the contrast live while it's playing. I can jump back and forth, change the brightness, and I can change the way that it interprets the image. Will it make $1 million? No. Is it cool? I think so. So this was my first hobby project. I had to modify C or C++ code, and I had to recompile mPlayer to get it to work the way I wanted it. And then I was VJing for my friends' bands and VJing to my DJ sets. And I could do all this in a live way. And at the same time, I was promoting open source software, single board computers, and letting people know that they could try this at home with low financial backing. Any questions about this? I paused it here. You can see it's not pixels. It's full ASCII art.
Are the patches up on GitHub?
And
do they work with MPV now that it's sort of...
Whatever works with mPlayer can play through this.
All right.
It does have libAA
right.
in plain. If you install mPlayer, you can run this. I do not have the patches that I've made to it on GitHub, but once I clean it up a little, maybe I'll do it. And, sorry.
Yeah. I was just curious, what percentage of the broken Raspberry Pis come back that you're able to actually fix as opposed to replace?
I've gotten two back that were broken, and it was the same kid, and he did the same thing. And I didn't realize what he had done until I really tried to troubleshoot it. And then once I couldn't figure it out, I really interrogated him more. And it's a funny story. So are you familiar with the Raspberry Pirate Radio project? It's a, you can connect one wire to the fourth pin on the inside, and then there's a Python script where you can make it output FM radio signals. It's a pirate radio station. It doesn't broadcast very far. I think it's about 50 meters every direction. So it's not all that useful, but it's a really cool project if you want to get a kid and show him, put a radio over there, put a Pi here. You can record a song yourself, broadcast it, and you can do that all with code. With one wire and a $30 computer. So I showed him that project. He was excited about it. I showed him more. I gave him a Raspberry Pi, took it home. The next day he comes back crying. It was the world to him. I had given him this thing. He had broken it. He had betrayed my trust. And it was okay. It was all okay. I gave him another one. I tried to troubleshoot it that night. Following day, he comes back. I broke this one too.
What?
And I wasn't mad. That was my last Raspberry Pi that I had to give out for the moment. I eventually got some Raspberry Pi Zeros. I gave him one of those. He still has it, it still works. So what happened was, instead of using one of these nice cables where there's a plastic casing around the connection, he used some aluminum foil.
Ow.
Oh.
And if you wrap some aluminum foil around the end of this, there's a 3-volt out, another 3-volt out, and a 5-volt out.
Oh.
So he fried his board, and there was no way to recover that, and the power supply as well. That's what happened when he took it home and tried to plug in his old power supply to the new board.
Oh.
So, exactly right. But I wasn't mad. It's all okay. We talked through why that happened. And then I learned something very powerful from that. If you give some kids some Raspberry Pis, buy some cheap cables and give them to them. A pack of 100 of these, $3 if you ship it from China on Amazon. It's cheap enough that you can buy some LED packs and some wires and give those along with the package. What I give as a package is the board itself, the power supply, some cables, LEDs, a $4 keyboard from Micro Center, a $4 mouse from Micro Center, and I used to give Wi-Fi dongles and power USB hubs, but with the Raspberry Pi 3, it has enough power, you can just use those four ports and it usually covers everybody. The Raspberry Pi Zero, you have to give out a power supply for and all these other adapters and a Wi-Fi card. And gets to be a lot of more trouble, especially when you're giving a kid that may not be that technical to begin with. But that's a learning experience. Any more questions about this ASCII art project before I continue? All right. So I don't have this slide on the Pi, so I'll show it to you first. If you're new to the Raspberry Pi, this is a picture from element 14. It shows what each part of it is. There's a camera that you can attach into this, headphone jack, HDMI, the power supply goes in here, it's micro USB. If you have a strong phone charger, that'll work as long as it's the right voltage. I have one of the touchscreen computers here, and that runs through this port. Instead of a hard drive, it runs off a micro SD card. The first one ran off of a full SD card. This one has Bluetooth, Wi-Fi built in, CPU, GPU, 10100 Ethernet port, 4 USB ports. And a really cool part, 40 GPIO pins, general purpose input output. For $30 down the street, it's a good deal.
Can you run a hard drive off this?
You could plug a USB hard drive into it.
And it would work.
Yeah.
Oh,
tends to need its own power supply. If you get one of the ones that just have the one wire, you may run into problems depending on the version. Yeah.
Is the micro SD card included in the
$30? It is not included in the $30, but Micro Center is $6. An 8 GB card is usually plenty.
So $36.
Plus a power supply. Here's the price breakdown. This does not include the TV. So $30 Raspberry Pi, $8 power supply, keyboard combo. You don't need the wireless adapter, three, class 10 SD card, HDMI cable, $78. Without the Wi-Fi, it's a little cheaper. So about $60. Here's a chart of the years and the original prices. The big different odd man out is the compute module. It has 200 input-output pins. We're talking about that in the question section. On the right, you can see the power of the CPUs. The original was slow, but through that limitation, do some really cool things with it. Now with the Raspberry Pi Zero, the $5 one, as soon as it hit market, it was sold out for months. I was doing a presentation in April in Pittsburgh, and I didn't have one leading up to it. So kept checking all the websites, and then eventually Micro Center carried them, and then it was sold out the next day. And then they'd get another shipment in, sold out the next day. So I had to just keep checking the local website, see when they had them.
What's included on this here?
I don't have a slide of the whole setup. I do have one that I can show you afterwards, though.
Okay.
It's a smaller board. It has the power supply. And then it has a mini HDMI and a micro USB on the go. So you have to convert all those things out into full-size ports.
Does it have Bluetooth?
It doesn't have Bluetooth, so you'd have to add a USB Bluetooth dongle through a powered USB hub. It's a lot of extra things. Usually you'd want to go with a 3B, but if you want to put a whole computer into your shoe for some kind of wearable, crazy shoe project, you'd want a small form factor, and depending on the power, it uses less power, so if you want something to run off a battery for longer, it might be 3-0.
It doesn't have the headers, too, on the GPIO.
It doesn't have pins, but it
right.
does have holes, so
right.
you have to solder them yourself.
Right, so you have to mount, if you want to, you know, plug in, you have to mount the headers.
Right. But it still has them.
Yeah.
It still works the same. Just a little more DIY effort. But you can turn that into a learning experience.
And the new Zero actually has a camera connection.
Right, it has the same port.
Right.
That's pretty much all it adds.
It's the same price.
Same price.
You're not overclocking, do you need a heat sink?
I've never overclocked, and I've never used a heat sink. I think it's kind of silly, myself. I think the only thing that my kids have been interested in where you'd want to overclock is if you emulate a Nintendo 64. But I'm not interested in that, so I'll just skip that.
A few years ago, I think one of the original models, I tried setting one up as a router for an IPv6 project.
Okay.
And I didn't get the thing working. And my understanding is because the Ethernet that was using the USB chip, it was doing something weird with the USB DOM, with the USB Ethernet knob I was trying to use. And I just doing some bad work on it. I wonder if that's working any better on the new models.
OpenWRT as a distribution now you can install if you want to get into network and router things. I suggest checking that one out.
Install it on the Raspberry Pi.
Yep. So the rest of the presentation will be on the Pi. Most of you already know how to use Linux, GNU Linux, Unix, so forth. But if you're showing this to somebody else, where would you start? I will show you how I approach it. I'm not trying to talk down to you. I know I'm in a room of people that probably make more money than me and are probably better sysadmins than me, but I want you to take this from the perspective of the learner and think about others. How could you present this to someone else as a way to get into Linux, the new Linux? And I want your feedback on this. I don't know everything. Together we know more than each of us individually. So I'm going to do a lot of things on the command line. I love using the command line when I'm showing this stuff. It gets people into the hacker mentality where they're getting into the grid of it. And if you do everything through the GUI tools, why aren't they just using Windows or whatever else? Linux, Unix, the power is from the command line. It's from scripting things. It's from not even using a monitor at all, and SSHing into headless setups. And two of my Raspberry Pis that are running as we speak don't have a keyboard and mouse connected to them. They're just displays, and they run 24 hours a day. And if I just use GUI tools, couldn't do that. So, I'm going to skip how to set it up. There's so much documentation on how to do that. At the end of the presentation, I'll give you my GitHub page. It goes into all the grit of how to do it, links to videos of how to set it up. I trust you're all able to install the system yourself. One thing I like to show is the Synaptic Package Manager. It's a great way to show all of the software that is available to install with a couple clicks. And how do you install the Synaptic Package Manager? It used to be, when I started using Ubuntu, it came pre-installed. But how do you install that? So you go apt-get, update, and then it doesn't do anything. I'm not connected online, so I'm not actually going to run it. But you need admin rights. So sudo. To teach this, I love to use xkcd. I'm sure it's all your favorite web comic.
A little bigger.
Oh, sure.
Visual test.
Control Plus is it?
Only on, I think, KDE and
point everyone where it's classic.
So, make me a sandwich. No, do it yourself. Sudo make me a sandwich. Okay. That's the quickest way to teach sudo. People love comics. You use them to your advantage if there's one available. So then after you sudo apt-get install -s synaptic. Start it up, and then it has the gigantic list of all available software. You can page through it. There's thousands of packages. You can use the search tool to ask them what their favorite package is, do a search, see thousands of results.
Question? What age group are you typically working with?
I teach during the summer 6 through 12, and then throughout the year 8 through 18, with the most in the 10 to 12 range. But I also teach to teachers and to musicians, adults, so forth. These concepts could get anybody into Linux and GNU. Do you have a question? No? Okay. We get into Python. Python is one of the easiest to learn and read programming languages. It's debatable. You might like Ruby or JavaScript or HTML or I don't care what your favorite programming language is. You can use what you like. I like to use Python.
Fortunately, Bill Ricker's not here.
And the reason for that is if you read a Python script from top to bottom, usually tell what's going on. There's usually comments. The variables are usually full names. The calls are usually full names. That's my opinion. So the thing I like to start off with is, I don't like to start off with it, but I would love an alternative, hello world. So the Python 2 way of doing it, which makes everything more confusing, is print space, open quote, hello world. And this is Python 2.7, so it acts like 3 as well. So you can do it the other way. Open parenthesis, open quote, hello world.
Actually, that's not quite correct in that situation. You're supposed to do import from future.
It's not necessary in Python 7. 2.7.
Yes, but the problem is certain things behave. If you're trying to make something happen between Python 2.7 and 3, it is best to do that because that way certain things break in.
Yeah, if you
want to make something totally compatible with both, it's a lot of work.
Which is fine. The problem is that the Python 2 stuff, some of the Python 2 print will break. Which is also a good thing. So
out of the box, that's all the box. So I assume C compiler, C++ compiler.
If you don't have all the tools, you can sudo apt-get install build essential.
Perl's available.
Perl. Okay. I'm pretty sure it comes with Perl off the bat. You can verify that. Yeah. And probably not because of the headiness. I also like to talk about how to get help. You can always Google things. That's how everybody does things. But Python has its own built-in help program. And to get out of that, type quit. And to close the program, you do the quit function. Then I like to get into how to write your own script. Now we could do the same thing, but we'll skip that. And I like to jump into loops. Most people teach programming, getting loops in much later. But if you're into games, which is most of what my kids are involved in, you have to get into looping pretty quick, so that's the second thing I do. Or I skip these two steps altogether and just jump into games. When I'm teaching somebody something, I like to use Nano. If you show somebody Vi, they may never quit. So I'm going to run this one. The only difference was I put while capital true colon and I tabbed out the print. So it ran very fast. I control C to stop it. And if I page up, it did a whole lot, and you can't see the original commands anymore. If you want to do regular Python programming, I usually send them to Code Academy. It's a 13-hour introductory course. But if you do 2 to 4 hours on it, you can pick up the syntax and read some documentation, pick up some modules, and get actual useful things done with it. The 13 hours is very looming to people that aren't necessarily devoted to programming quite yet, but 2 to 4 hours, read some documentation, you're fine. If you really want to get go into school for it and get a cool job with it, then yeah, complete it out. But if you're just a hobbyist, you don't need very much of it. So, built in to the default Raspbian, this is a slimmed down version of Debian. There's not RenPy, that's a project I'm working on with some other people, but Python Games and Minecraft Pi Edition. Python Games are nifty. So it's this small list of programs. And the names are kind of weird, but they are games that people are familiar with. Wormy is snake. Four in a row, that's Connect Four. Flippy, reversey. Tetromino, that's Tetris. Gem Gem is Bejeweled. These are all common games that people know, and you can modify them. They are in Python. So this is Wormy, or Snake. Simple enough, you go and eat the apple and don't hit the walls. Every time you eat the apple, you get longer. And the code is not very long for this game. This uses the Pygame library. Is anybody familiar with Pygame? It's great for doing simple things. If you want to get into full 3D first-person shooters, don't use Pygame. But if you want to play around with learning a language, Pygame's great. If you want to teach kids, Python's great. Pygame is great. So these are all in the Python Games folder from the home directory. So if you do an ls, this is all the resources for all these games. You can run them from the command line. So I'm going to run squirrel.py. This one is maybe a little different. This is a squirrel that's trying to dodge larger squirrels and eat smaller squirrels. Every time you eat a smaller squirrel, you get bigger. And then you eventually become the biggest squirrel. If you play long enough, then you win. Without playing too long, you soon become the biggest squirrel. And the longer you run in one direction, the bigger you'll get. After the end game, you keep playing, and you keep getting bigger and bigger until the game crashes. It's a fun game, especially for kids.
So this is Katamari Squirrel.
Exactly. In the third line of the comments, it is based on Katamari Damacy. Got it right. But it's 2D Katamari Damacy. And the longer you let it sit, it'll just keep zooming into its hand. And it'll just keep getting more zoomed in, and slower, and more bogged down, and then it will crash. So all of this is open source, some BSD license. So nano squirrel.py. So I was wrong, first line, 2D Katamari Damacy Clone. All these games are made by this guy, Al, and he has a website, Invent with Python, and also has some books that accompany these scripts. If you read the books, you can build the games yourself. But I developed a lesson plan to get kids into the Raspberry Pi and modifying games, using the concept of circuit bending. Is anybody familiar with circuit bending? So circuit bending is a way to teach circuitry backwards. One of my old friends, he was in a noise band, and he showed me circuit bending. So the way it works is you take a sound toy, whether it's a little Casio keyboard, or a little piano, or a doll that when you squeeze his hand, it says, I love you. You take something that has a sound chip, you take a screwdriver to it, you open it up, you take a look at the board, you take one of these wires, and you connect two parts of the board that may not normally connect, and you listen. Usually you set it to a demo mode, connect two wires together, and is the sound different? And you can take a pen and paper, make a diagram of the board, take notes on what connections make what sound. It's a way to make alien instruments out of a $5 thing from the thrift store or some trash on the side of the road. The holy grail is the speak and spell. If you do a Google search for speak and spell circuit bending, you can find people selling circuit bend speak and spells on eBay and YouTube videos of people that have added buttons and knobs and things to the side of these speak and spells so that it doesn't sound like it originally did. Sounds pretty weird to begin with, but it's a cool thing. So using that concept, starting with a blank page is boring. Starting with someone else's code and modifying it, that's a lot more fun. And you get more immediate results, instant gratification, if you're playing a game. So the thing I like about Al's games is that nearly everything has a comment. That's the pound sign, the hashtag, whatever you want to call it. And that's skipped by the interpreter. Everything's got a good variable name. And you can pretty much figure out what's going on. One thing that isn't very clear to kids is how the colors work. Brass color equals open paren 24 comma 255 comma 0 close paren. Talking to a group of very intelligent people, that is RGB. Those are 0 to 255. And let's change it. Brass color, what do you want it to be?
Yellow.
White, zeros.
White? Pink? So how would you make pink?
Just red.
Red? How else do you make pink? was that?
I put 105 for BLU as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I don't know. We can do the experiment.
Let's try it out. Hit save it. Close it. Run it again.
Well,
not bad.
Need to lighten it up a little. Take some off the red.
So it works.
Close enough.
I don't think the original Raspberry Pi could do this, but the Raspberry Pi 3 can run GIMP. So you could import the squirrel PNG and you could change that as well. So what would be a good color that would go with a pink background?
Blue.
Blue? Okay. GIMP has the same system, RGB, a little more visual. But it's really small, so you have to zoom in. Blue squirrel. Overwrite that. Destructive change. Instant gratification. Now you could also download pictures from their favorite shows or whatever they're interested in. You can replace those pictures with whatever you like. I've been doing this project with kids for a little while, so I have some examples. This one doesn't look anything like the original. It looks more like a space adventure of some sort. Some of the kids have made bouncing shoes on asphalt. This is Nyan Eat Nyan, the Nyan cat flying around in space eating other Nyan cats. And this kid drew all these shapes himself. He took the grass into GIMP and changed the pixels and made his own Nyan cat and had a little Nyan cat riding beside it too. This is a kid's face. Took a picture with a webcam and added many more sprites to the game.
There's a lot of them.
And it's now much easier. The health bar is cranked up to way more than it should be. And the speed of everything is way more than it should be. But it's pretty fun. Kid was proud of it.
You need more JPEG.
Yeah. He kept the original quality of the image size of the squirrel PNG, but he put his own face into it. Pygame can handle the full size picture if you want, but I thought that was cool. There's a lot more you can do with Pygame, but I'm going to move on. Does anybody have any questions about Pygame? I think it's a great way to get people in from 0 to 60, changing variables, seeing results. You can do a lot more with it too. Something I like to do is with Squirrelly Squirrel, you can change the left and right direction. So whenever he's going left, he's looking right, moonwalking. I'm going to talk briefly about the input-output pins. All right, so this is a very simple script to pull up the pins with Python. I've commented everything, so it's pretty simple. It has its own Python library, rpi.gpio, and also wait, so there's the time module as well. Same variable concept as in the Pygame. LED equals 7, that tells it which pin you're going to use. Some of the pins are just ground, some of them are just constantly voltage outputs, some are reprogrammable. So this next section tells it how to use it. LED 7 pin is going to be an output. And it's going to turn it to 1 on wait a moment, turn it off, wait a moment. Pretty simple. Now if I was to run that, it would not work. Since it has hardware changing capabilities, you have to add sudo. There it is. That's really simple. Making a light, turn on and off, you could do that with an Arduino. But if you can turn on a light, you can turn on a motor. There's a lot more that you can do with it. You can build circuits. You can play with resistors. Could build a home security system that's smart enabled. You can use your imagination, find something that interests you, and make it happen. You could make robots. There's a whole book on building a Raspberry Pi controlled robot. It looks like a moon rover, big thing. I haven't done that project yet, but. I'm not a hardware guy, so I'm going to move on. Does anybody have any questions about the GPIO pins? I'll try to answer them.
Do you want to use this for fine motor control and real-time capabilities?
So if you, the more you approach real-time, mm-hmm. the more you should use Arduino. But if your application doesn't need real time and it can handle with low latency, it all depends on the project. If your project is real time, Python is not a good option. You could use a different way to approach it. Could
well, but even if you wrote it in C, it's still dealing with the kernel latencies.
Right, but there's better kernel patches that you can do. But Python, you never know when it's going to garbage collect. So don't use Python. I'll show you some of the other scripts I have. This is doing the same thing, but with syscalls. This would maybe be a little more real time.
On your way through that, how small a value can you put in that?
I don't know, the one that's asleep. Or iPhones.
So it would be more the other way around. Turn it on for 2/10 of a second. Wait for one. Turn it on for 1/10 of a second. Wait. So that you can get a more accurate motor control.
I don't know the limits of it. Does anybody else know the fine-tuned controls of sleep and weight?
Is there a library in Python to do pulse width modulation?
Good question.
Again, that's a problem. It's going to run into the kernel latency.
Garbage collection and kernel latency. Back to Wormy. I'm going to move on from the hardware. Wormy had that cool little spiral title screen and then got into the game. I took Wormy and I changed the code all around. And first I'll show you the first iteration. One of my kids, his name is Mario, not to be confused with the Luigi and Mario. He told me a very sad story. He has never beaten a game. Teenager, age of 16, never beaten a game. Played games, never beat one. So I wanted to fix that. Made a very simple game. Press the enter key to beat the game. Press the enter key now. Of course, I handed it to him, and he...
Yeah. He didn't enter. He still didn't win.
You still eventually have to press enter, but after you've pressed anything else, you lose. Try again. I'll pull that up again.
Just did it, right?
If you actually do it, you do win. Now you can say that the only game that you beat is the game that Mario beat. It wasn't very good. That was my first Python 3 program. And it's very simple. I can show you the code. Very simple. Probably not correct. If you want to do it, you have to actually listen for any other keystrokes and so forth. Pygame happens to have that sort of functionality, so I made the game much heavier by modifying a program that already had that built into it. So this is the sequel to the game that Mario beat, the game that Mario beat 2. And it's got that same title screen from Wormy, but now I added the title of this game, and it's much more flashy. At the bottom right, you probably can't see it very well. Press any key to play. Same concept. Press the enter key. Of course, you don't want to press the enter key if you're told to press the enter key. You lose. Try again. Press any key to play. Restarts the program in a loop. Press the enter key or return key to win. You win. Now that actually worked. As soon as I pressed a key, it said you lose. As soon as I pressed enter, it won. It's a fun little thing. Some people have made incredible programs. If you have some kids that you want to get into Python, there's a yearly event called Pi Week, where kids try to make a game in a week, and then they post it online, and there's an award ceremony or something, and there's some really great games that you can see from the 21 past competitions that they've done. I'll show you the code for that. It's a lot more complicated. It involves random pygame and sys, has a lot of the same color variables as Wormy, and involves a lot of extra things, more functions, and all that code's online. So, can anyone tell me what the number one highest selling game of all time is? Good guess. Any other guesses?
Donkey Kong,
good guess.
Solitaire.
Maybe if you count all the Windows license fees.
What is it? Windows 10 it isn't even included anymore or something. It's like you have to rent it or something.
I guess there officially is no good thing about Windows 10.
Well, it's got Bash. You can use Bash and Linux.
Been there, done that, got it. Most people think it's Mario. There's hundreds of Mario games. That's probably an exaggeration. But they've sold on consoles for years. But it's a newer title. It is Minecraft. I think that's partially because they keep re-releasing it, and you have to buy it each time. So a lot of the kids I know have it on their Xbox and the computer and their phone, and they pay for it 3 times at least. But there's a special version that comes with the Raspberry Pi. And it's called Minecraft Pi Edition. And it comes in this small window. Kids want things to be big. They hit the maximize button. It doesn't work as well. It's the mouse area is still on the top left. So keep it the way it is. I'm going to delete this world. We'll start fresh. On the original Pi, it took a long time to generate a world. On the Pi 3, it took a couple seconds. The controls are simple. You can walk around in this digital world. You can destroy things. You could dig into the earth. Now, in the top left, probably can't see it very well, but there's the letters POS, colon, and then there's 3 numbers, -13, 9.3, and 4.5, and the numbers are separated by commas. That is the XYZ axis of this world. You can think of X and Z as one direction and another direction, and then Y is vertical up and down. Mojang, the company that originally made Minecraft, saw the Raspberry Pi and they said, we want kids to learn how to program. We want some cross promotion. We're going to make a version for the Raspberry Pi. It's not going to be full featured, but it's going to help kids to program. So they added a Python API and a Java API. Those are cool. So I'm going to leave this game running. I'm going to Alt Tab so I have control of the mouse. Make this window reasonable. I'm going to use LeafPad for this. I like to do it in three windows. LeafPad is kind of like gedit, but lighter weight, perfect for single board computers. And it's got the ampersand at the end of it. That sends it as a background process. So I still have control of the terminal while I have this text editor open. And I will go ahead and make this bigger. So it's got its own module that comes pre-installed on Raspbian. It's MCPI, Minecraft Pi. And from that, I'm importing two submodules, Block and Minecraft. Minecraft allows you to connect to the game and to post to the chat system within the game. There is multiplayer available for this. So if you had one router and 13 Pis, a bunch of kids could play together, and they could script it to chat to each other or chat manually to each other. So this first line, MC equals Minecraft.minecraft.create, that's not an exciting line, but it connects Python API to the game that we have open. The next one, MC.post-to-chat, is the hello world for Minecraft. It posts hello Minecraft world inside the game. What I really like is this next set, the block submodule. It allows you to put blocks in the game through code. It uses the same three numbers as it's in the top left corner. So some kids are very analytical. They'll get in the game, go to a spot, look at the top, say, where am I? Okay, write those numbers down, and I'll put a block there. Some kids are more theoretical. This project is better for kids. I wouldn't suggest bringing this up to some of your adult friends. But it's a cool way to get kids involved. So, my name is Michael. I made an M in code. So I'm going to run it. That's Python Minecraft hack.py. Now, it's not really a hack. It's an API that Mojang made. But by using terms like hack, and get people more interested in things that might be more mundane. They could just build it by right-clicking and placing the blocks, but they don't have to. So I'm going to run it. Let's see what happens. Hello, Minecraft world. Shows up. I'm going to take control of this. And here it is. This was not here a second ago. I just generated this world. We can destroy it. We can build it again. There's a lot more you can do with it. Some people have made giant clocks that work in real time. Cool project is connecting the camera module and building a digital real-world photo booth. When your character in the game steps into a photo booth, presses the button, takes a picture in real time and saves it to a hard drive or uploads to Twitter or whatever. It's all Python, so you can mix it with other concepts. You can make loops. You could light up a light. Just happen to have a script lying around that loops with the light. Kids at work call me Mr. Mike. So I challenge people, how can you build your own name? How can you change the block? How can you look up the documentation to do something more? This is simple, this is scratching the surface, but what else can you do with it? And if you present that challenge to someone and they take you up on it, then they will learn much more than whatever you show them. While it's doing this, it's also using the GPIO library, and it's turning on this light. Question?
Does the API also include a way to have the game talk back? So, for instance, if a character reaches a particular set of coordinates, it can set off a proximity alarm, lights and sirens type of a thing, stuff like that. Does it have that capability?
It does. That's how the photo booth project works.
Okay.
Good question. I don't know the answer to that.
Probably didn't access the hardware correctly.
It's all open source, so dig into the code, see what happens. All right, I did it the same way, I guess I didn't need to. I don't know if that changed at some point.
When you try the other one with pseudo, it seems to work.
When I first wrote this a long time ago, the operating system has updates. The original config steps were much more involved now. It's a lot easier. So maybe they built it with Python to have admin rights. It's probably a huge security block, but processing. It's a programming language. It's another introductory programming language. It's for visual art. Processing works on all platforms, Android, iOS, Windows, Mac, Linux. It's a cool one. I was introduced to it from visual artists. I met a guy who would write a script and let it run on his beefed up machine for 4 days straight. At the end of 4 days, he would hit a button, save it, and he had the size cranked up so he could then print it the size of this wall. And wow. He would sell that piece for $30,000. Piece of code into real analog art and sell it. And that's how he made his living. When you tell that to a kid, that kind of blows their mind. How can you make creative art with code that can make money? That's a hard thing to do. But if you get good at anything and you present it well enough, you can do it. Processing is built on JavaScript, sort of Java. Uses that syntax. It's a framework. It's pretty easy to get into. This is one that I've modified from, this may cause seizures. it's interactive. So as I move the mouse, it draws a square of random size, random color, random border, wherever it's at. If I click, it changes to an ellipsis. So it kind of lets me draw. It's running a loop over this code, and it's not clearing the loop. If I right click, it's going to be a triangle. And it kind of makes a weird shape. Could I sell this and make $30,000? Probably not. But if I spent another 30 hours on the code, maybe I could. Projects like this are very fun on the touch screen. Down the street, you can get the $70 7-inch touchscreen. Works great for little projects where you have an information kiosk and you want to do some kind of input to it. Send information to a bigger display or something like that. Or just to mess around with the processing for your language. I'll show you one more. This is modified from someone else's code. Theirs was circles, changed it to triangles. What this does is it makes triangles of various sizes, random shapes, random sizes, random positions, and then each of them moves randomly on their own independently. And the longer you let this run, the more unique it becomes. And this is called generative art. This process of having code, running it, making something unique. If you're here during the question section, you saw my background on my laptop. It's full screen of random triangle behavior. Every time you let it fill up the screen, it's something unique. The longer it lasts, prettier it looks, in my opinion. Any questions about processing? Something interesting. There's
so while it's
hundreds
doing,
of examples.
While it's doing that, how much of the actually the CPU is it really working through?
If you look up in the top right, there's actually a real-time CPU gauge, and I think it was around 30%. That's a very good question. With the original Pi, you had to always watch that gauge. If you had two or three programs running, it would be at 100, it would stall, couldn't do anything. You could keep trying to control C and control Q and QQQ and try all the different variations to try to quit the program, and hopefully some of those signals would send, and hopefully you'd get control of it again. With the Pi 3, a lot of the software is built for lightweight use, so that's not as much of an issue. I think I had GIMP running with some other things running, and it felt fine. When I ran GIMP on the Raspberry Pi for the first time, I was actually very surprised. So this is, I ran it again. This is different from the time before. It's set to be near HD, 1080, 16:9 ratio. You could set it to be 4K resolution. You wouldn't be able to see it all on this HDMI setup the way we have it, but you can still output that file to a 4K file. It would be a lot slower, but you could print that result, whatever size you want.
You've shown a number of different programming systems that kids might be interested in using. I'm wondering, is it possible to run the Scratch system on a Raspberry Pi?
I'm not sure about the Scratch website, but I think it comes with the old Scratch program.
Right, the original Scratch program that was, I forget what it was written, but some maybe ML-based thing, I forget.
Yes. So there's Scratch.
Okay. The sort of a follow-up on that, unfortunately the new Scratch website is all implemented in Flash, and I assume that's not available?
I've only tried working with Flash on the B+. I haven't tried it since then. It was very slow, unusable state then.
What implementation of Flash was there for ARM?
It's probably a recompile of whatever
okay.
Ubuntu restricted extras package installs. I don't know.
Okay.
I don't like Flash. I also don't like Scratch. It's blasphemy saying that as someone who teaches. But I'll tell you why. Scratch is great to teach young kids how to program and some like programming logic. But it doesn't go that next step. It says, you're a programmer. Yeah, good job. You've done so many lines of code. Great. Keep programming in Scratch, because they want to promote their platform. And there's not a next step shown. So a lot of teachers are using Scratch all throughout K through 12. And then kids think, hey, I'm a programmer. So what do? They go to college. They enroll in CS classes. Then what happens? C++, Java, JavaScript, real programming, typed things. That's different. And they fail. And then they quit.
I do understand what you're saying. There is one thing about Scratch which you somewhat alluded to, which I think is actually really helpful, is the community via the website is extremely supportive of the children who support each other. There's lots of things to work off there. Do any of these other systems have a similar community?
There is a Pi game website and the Pi Week that I mentioned earlier. Those are places that you can post your code, comment. It's more of a community involved thing. I've used Scratch quite a bit, and if you don't force a kid to make an account and to build something themselves, it becomes another game platform website. How many games are built on the Scratch website? Thousands. And kids can play games for days, days and days and days, and not get bored. All right, so they find a game that they really like. All right, you can click that button at the top. Show the code. If it's a really complex game that's really good, that code is unreadable, unmaintainable, unmixable, and it's all overlapping, so
well,
it fits
in
the window.
Well, I mean, anybody can write unmaintainable code in any language, and I don't think a 10-year-old writing a Pi game is going to write maintainable comment code either.
That's true.
So that's kind of irrelevant.
That's the way I see it. It's not the common opinion. If you ask 100 technology teachers, probably 100 will say Scratch is the best thing that's ever made.
I do agree there is a step that you have to take.
I think it's a great tool to introduce it, but you have to go on to something else. You have to use it as a trampoline to bounce from. If you just stick with it, kids will stay on there forever. Something cool about Python, there's a lot of modules that can be installed. If you can't do something yourself or write something yourself, you can probably Google and find somebody that's put together a framework or something that gets you most of the way there. If you combine enough things, you can make something really cool. Computer vision is one of the coolest advanced things that I've seen with it. OpenCV, you can import that and do facial recognition, image processing, video processing. Computer vision is the art of teaching a computer how to see. It's very complicated, but an adult friend of yours that wants to know when his car pulls up and parks in front of his house to record a video, you can do that. The possibilities of that and the Pi and a camera really open up a lot of cool things. At one point I made a program in Python with OpenCV to take a biological slide of sample tissue and tissue sample, set it back. To process that image, isolate the part that they wanted, and run that through some data analysis. And that is an incredible thing that cannot be done with Scratch. Scratch is limited to that 2D animation scape. There's Scratch X where you can do more things with, but Python is a really incredible thing. If you can show somebody Python and they run with it, there are jobs in Python. Who uses Python professionally? I see at least four hands. That is something cool. For an introductory language to be actually usable, that is incredible. There's a lot of projects. Even if you're not really creative and you want to program your own thing, there are hundreds of projects. If you go to the nearest bookstore, there are at least three magazines that have Raspberry Pi projects in them. You could buy that magazine or just buy a cup of coffee, flip through, find a project that looks cool to you. MagPi is the main one. Every issue of MagPi is Creative Commons, I believe. You can download them all for free. They're PDFs, you can read them, find projects. Those are cool projects. There are Raspberry Pis on the ISS, International Space Station. You can write some Python code, test it out on your Pi, submit it to the ISS, and have it run in space. We couldn't do that when we were kids. I want to run some code in space. I want to get some temperature readings, some visual readings from an IR sensor in space. Can you do that? That's not realistic when we were kids. Now you can actually do it. That's exciting. I've seen some videos of installation pieces, interactive art spaces, the Beacons Project. Forget the whole name, but you walk into this space and they give you a box with some headphones. It's battery powered, has a little screen, and as you walk closer to Bluetooth beacons, the sound changes in a live way. Adds something really cool, a personalized, unique experience to this space. Everyone has the same chance to make those sounds, but did you put it in the same place, close to that beacon and that beacon to make it that sound? Each box has a Raspberry Pi in it, headphone jack, and a battery, and a little screen. That's a cool project. You can build a robot, you can build a web server. Something I do at work is I have a very intense host file. And when kids go to a website that I don't want them to go to, it redirects to my Raspberry Pi. It runs a little web server. It's a little bit of HTML, CSS. And instead of being a content filter dead end, no, you can't go to that website. Instead, it's options. Here are websites that you can go to. You can go to Code Academy. You can go to Scratch, you can go to NitroType, you can go to all these different great places, you can learn something, you can be productive. Instead of just saying, no, you can't do that. If you tell an employee or a kid, no, you can't do that, what are they going to do? They're going to look for a way around that, try to bypass that system. But if you give them other options, they'll do something else. I made that possible with a Raspberry Pi. I can run it all day, every day. It's 5 volts. My boss isn't going to complain. Hey, you're using too much power with all those servers. 15 volts. I have 3 Pis running all the time. Cool project I saw was a universal translator. You could say something into a microphone, hit stop, speech to text, text to translation, translation back in text, text to speech once again, and you could hear what somebody in another language just said a moment ago. That is a cool project.
That library, or all of that's not happening on a Pi, is it?
Yeah. Well, the translation part uses the Pi's internet connection to Google API or something like that.
Is the speech text happening on the Pi?
I think so. Can't remember. I think so, though. I have a link in my notes Welcome to check it out, try it yourself. Smart devices, smart homes are really popular with the name brand things. You don't often know what is running on the device. If their server goes down, you might be left with a very expensive paperweight. If you build it yourself, you know most of what it's running. Before we came in the room, we were talking about Stallman. The FSF does not approve the Raspberry Pi because of the GPU. It actually boots the GPU first. And that's the only binary blob that's common for GPUs. But if there's an open board, I would love to hear about it. A very popular project, I try not to tell my kids about it, is the RetroPi project. Yeah. It's a whole lot of emulators all on the Pi. If you're really into hardware, making a game cabinet with a Pi on the inside, people can make tiny little interactive game cabinets without too much price. Some people put them inside old Game Boys, the big, thick, classic Game Boy, put a Raspberry Pi Zero in there, battery, some buttons into the GPIOs, and make a game system that can run Genesis and Super Nintendo and all that stuff. You can build a camera. If you built a camera housing and a button, a battery, Pi module, the camera module, Raspberry Pi Zero. You make a really small HD camera that you could use, however you like. Could be like a GoPro size thing. You could build your own cloud. That's a cool project. Last meeting, we were talking about clouds and building your own cloud. You could run a cloud on a Raspberry Pi that's at your house and pull your information from there. Then you'd have more control over it, and it wouldn't be a big power bill. If you're into 3D printing, you could print cases for them. That's a cool project. I made a couple. Cool project, had this set up at my old house. Raspberry Pi connected to your stereo. You could put all of your music onto a hard drive, and you could run an MPD server, music player daemon, and with your phone through the Wi-Fi, you could choose the next song you want to play and let it manage all your music. We talked about media centers during the Q&A. You can play HD video. When Jerry was talking at the beginning, I had that video looping that was from a Pi Jam. Plays video very nicely. You can build your own tablet like I have here. Build your own surveillance system. Does anybody have any other ideas for Raspberry Pi projects? There's quadcopters people made out of Raspberry Pi Zeros. It's such a small form factor. It's pretty cool. Mentioned wearables earlier. If you're into motorcycling, you could wire it up so that your jacket has turn signals. The whole right side lights up. Blinks, left side blink. Some cool stuff people have done. You could build a supercomputer. Attach enough cores together and two Wi-Fi cards, mesh net.
Didn't we do that a few years ago? Where's Kurt?
Sort of.
We built one out in the parking lot.
I've seen 256 connected together in a column. The
a few years ago, Federico showed a Raspberry Pi laptop. And he used this laptop like display and keyboard that was originally designed for an AT&T cell phone.
That's cool. The GCHQ, Great Britain's NSA equivalent, they wanted to promote parallel processing, so they made a 66 Raspberry Pi cluster. If you want to get into that sort of thing, it's a very low barrier to entry for price and output. That's all I have. At this point, I usually give away a Raspberry Pi, but I may make the least salary in this room, so you can afford it.
I don't know. I think I might have you beat.
Thanks, Mike.